Welcome to the STEM Professionals Chat by STEM Care. The purpose of this podcast is to bring career stories from the STEM professional, which is science, technology, engineering, mathematics, especially who undertook non-traditional career paths. We hope that career journey discussion with professionals from STEM community will be helpful for you, especially the students and earlier career professional, to craft your own career journey in the future. Today, I am Dr. Pawan and joining with my colleague, Dr. Rasika. In our virtual studio today, we have our guest, Dr. Bibhu Jain. Dr. Bibhu Jain has over 20-year experience of marketing, product management, digital transformation, and biomedical research in India and abroad. Currently, Dr. Bibhu is head of commercial marketing, Asia Pacific Research Solution for Merck Life Sciences. In this role, he oversees the development and execution of key marketing strategies, digital marketing, customer-centric program developments, launch of innovative products and services for Asia Pacific market. Prior to his career at Merck, Dr. Bibhu was head of marketing and business development for Corning Life Science in India. And also he was instrumental in executing the growth strategies for the company in India across the country. Dr. Bibhu holds a PhD degree in infectious disease from CSR M.Tech, Chandigarh, India. He worked during his PhD on quorum sensing, on pathogenesis of Vibrio cholerae and its interaction with the Entamoeba histolytica. Later, he went on to pursue an MBA from All In Business School, as well as jointly with IIT Bombay, Mumbai, and United States, Washington University in St. Louis. In addition, he has also completed a tech-led entrepreneurship program from IIM Bangalore, India recently. So thank you, Dr. Bibhu, for joining us today to share your career journey with us in our virtual studio.
Thank you, Dr. Bibhu, for joining today. And I'll start with the discussion. And we would like to know more about your journey and especially about the transition. And your transition is really a great, amazing, right, from PhD, life sciences to something called as MBA and completely different into a marketing. So how is this transition goes? Like, is there any specific inspiration? And this transition was pre-decided that, okay, I wanted to go in this path, or what was the thought process behind it?
Thanks, Rasika. Thanks, Pawan, for inviting me for this session. And thanks for saying a lot of kind words about my career journey. Rasika, this is a great question. Mostly for all of us who come from PhD background, there is nothing called pre-decided. Although we do a lot of things, but we are not pre-decided people. So what happened when I completed my PhD, my fiancé, she was still doing her PhD. And I was like, oh, if I go for postdoc, I don't know if she will still stay with me or not. Because so I was like, okay, what to do? I decided, okay, let me find something in India. And that's where I joined Millipore as a field application scientist. Same time, I was doing my tech-led entrepreneurship program from IIM Bangalore. And that program kind of opened my eyes that after PhD, there are a lot of other professions. So I joined Merck Millipore at that time as a field application scientist. And it worked well for me. Today, I am heading Merck Commercial Marketing for Asia Pacific for Research Business. Is almost like 13-14 year journey into marketing, and it has been pretty cool journey of 14 years from a lab rat to a marketing leader. So amazing time what I spent in this space.
That's great. So can you just little more elaborate about the program which you mentioned about IIM? Was that virtual or in person, or like how you went about it?
Okay, so when I was doing my PhD in 2006-07, it was like final year of the PhD. At that time, CSIR and IIM Bangalore, they decided that it is very important for PhD students to understand how to transition into industry, how to get into translational research. So CSIR started this program with IIM Bangalore, where they selected 20-30 folks from different CSIR institutes. And we got the best-in-class professors from IIM Bangalore teaching us finance, teaching us marketing, teaching us business entrepreneurship. And that's where your eyes get open. You feel in PhD, you learn everything, and that's where you say, oh, there is a money part also. And you start getting a wider understanding of how to convert inventions or innovation into a business case. And that's what I learned during that program.
If I had to do at that time, I don't think it would be easily for me, because generally people go for a postdoc abroad. That's like, his PhD comes from a renowned institute, and most of time, I think almost every colleague of his would have gone to abroad and doing something. So I would be interested to know that what was the thought process at that time, especially like, how did you convince yourself to stay back for the long term, because it was not a short period of time, you know, like we always compare and see and then get anxious and then we're not confident about what we do, right? So I'd be interested to know what was the thought process, how did you process your thoughts and kept yourself going?
Pawan, I will start with the line you use. We always compare and see where we are in comparison to others. I remember when I was completing my PhD, I got this offer from Merck Millipore at that time to join as a field application scientist. And another side, I was having offer of postdoc from Princeton to work with probably one of the best mind in the field of infectious biology. My director at that time of institute, Dr. Amit Ghosh, he was like, you tell me which lab in the world you want to go, because I don't want you to lose as a scientist. You are one of the good student for us. I don't want you to go in marketing. And I was like, no, sir, this is not like, I don't appreciate science. I really appreciate science. But I feel that I'm not someone who can be in a confined laboratory. I want to travel. I want to talk to people. I want to understand the different dimension of science, not just getting stuck into infectious biology. So I was like pretty convincing to him and others when I was taking a decision. I took a decision. I joined Millipore. I remember the first time when I was going for my first travel, it was in a sleeper bus from Bangalore to Trivandrum, and I was on the top seat. It was my first time in the life to be in a sleeper bus, and I was like, okay, what to do? And I got one phone with the internet. I am talking 2007, so I started looking into it. Fine, in Orkut, so that was a social media network at that time.
Right.
I'm not sure you guys use.
Yes.
Of my PhD graduates who got postdoc, they were putting how great they had a weekend in Miami Beach. And I was like, oh, these guys are enjoying it in Miami Beach, and I'm traveling in the overnight bus. And that was a lot of pressure. Every week I used to feel, am I taking a right decision? I'm talking to them, they say, oh, no, this is what we are doing. That is something we have to understand, that peer pressure is going to impact you. But I had the determination, whatever I opted for, I'm passionate about it. I'm gonna learn more about it. And that made me successful, I believe.
That's awesome.
I think that's I agree. Like many of us like want to get a quick fixes, like getting a postdoc of course gives us a lot of money as compared to India, like we earn a lot of money immediately. But I think that's investment. I think what you did at that point in time, now at least now you don't have to search for, okay, what to do, what should I do? so I think probably that way you kind of escaped the mid-career crisis, which is like after 7 years of postdoc, what I'm gonna do now? That's the question most of, I think, traditional career path people struggle with. And I think that's really a good learning lesson for our viewers. Yeah.
Right. And as you mentioned, like director of your institute has actually asked you what is your next research plan. And then that time you had your mind, which is like, you know, pretty much into going into something other than research. So this actually led me to the next question, that at every other stage we have mentors in our life, right? As you said, like we have research mentors, and then sometimes we have someone in the management. So how mentors in like your research path or your in general career path has played a role? How did you pick the mentor? How did you get help from the mentor? And do you have anything specific on it?
Thanks, Rasika. I was like, we were having sales summit last week, and one of the things someone asked, like, what is important for develop if you want to develop as a leader? And I say having a mentor, having a coach. Why? Mentors basically are the people who understand your strength and your weaknesses. They ask you why, and they help you in finding the right answer for your questions. So if you are having mentor, this is the only person who will give you undivided attention. But it's not easy to find a mentor. It's not like someone who you see the top shot is going to be a mentor. Okay. What I did in my career is I started looking into my strength, I started looking into my weaknesses, and then say, okay, this is probably one or two people who can help me in addressing the challenges which I face. Then you go to those people, you share with them, you need to be transparent to them, you need to share with them why you need them. And mostly this is a misconception that someone who is on the top, who is a big shot, or someone who is expert in a particular domain, they might not be ready to do mentoring. Everyone is looking to help others. And that's what something I realized. So when I was starting my career with Millipore, I went to Professor D.V.R. Seshadri from IIM Bangalore, who is a marketing professor. And I remember going to his house in Bangalore at some time, like he is cooking and he is telling me that, okay, after field application, think about marketing. He gave me the concepts of marketing. I remember when I started my job, a lot of people even telling me how to tie my shoes and why it is important to dress well. And so I had people who told me how to create your executive presence. Those are the different kind of mentors. I had people who told me finance. I remember in Corning, I had Sridhar Subramanian, who was a CFO for the company. I used to go to him, he used to teach me how to create business cases, how to do NPVs, and all these things. So these are, like, I can keep talking about the people who had been mentored, but number one, go to them, ask for help. Number two, tell them that you are taking them as a mentor and it will require them to spend some time with you.
Okay.
Number three, visit, talk to them with the right problems so that they can teach you. Don't go just to gossip with them. So that helps. Mentoring is critical for the career. That's what I see. I still have mentors who are guiding me for my next phase.
And can I just ask another question? Do you also act as a mentor, or like what is your experience?
I do. Like, there are few people in the organization. Even there are sometimes people who are great people, but they feel they are not having confidence of speaking in English. Like, I live in Korea, so there are people who don't know how to do business communication in English. There are people who want to transition from academia to business, but you can't mentor more than 3 to 4 people in a year if you really want to give them undivided attention. I wake up at morning 4, sometimes I talk to these people who are not in the same time zone. It's fun, but I do, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I really appreciate that awesome. You take off your time and really helping people out of nothing to get in return. And I think that's what is needed. I think people like you, actually, like for you, somebody had invested and gave their time. So this is like giving back to the to the people because tomorrow they will be tomorrow's leader. So that's really a good thing at your part. I have a question about this is a typical phobia in a PhDs across the world or researcher, I would say bench researcher is. So everybody thinks that, you know, we feel like we are a light group of people, like PhDs and postdocs, like we don't want to go and talk to people about a product or probably we fear that we cannot do it because we don't know what. There would be like backlashes. We don't fear to fail in a lab, but we fear to fail in the field, right? Because people will see it. So, I mean, what would be your advice for such people who may probably want to get into such field, but they have this mental block that probably I may not be having enough skills to go and work in the field work, even if it is like even related to my research or related to my work, but going and working in the field is tough. So what advice would be that these are the skills they might have and they might able to use in the business and all these different kind of jobs which are not bench work?
And I can add it up, like how to develop those skills, like how to go about it. I think he can.
Thanks for that, Rasika. Before I jump onto this, I just want to add something on the mentorship, if that's okay with you guys.
Sure.
We call something called as reverse mentoring. Although like we are the leaders in the organization, but we have limited knowledge. We are like I am Generation X, which is more than 40 years old. New generations bring a lot of knowledge. They are sharper than us. So we also look for people who are younger than us and who can mentor us, who can teach us how to run fast, how to learn new technologies. So I'm taking this opportunity of your platform. If any one of you feel you guys can mentor me from the audience, please reach out to me. I would be keen to learn from you. That's something I am being my
that's,
marketer.
That's so humble and nice. So humble and nice of you that, you know, I think surely people would be more of a forward mentoring, I think. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah.
So, thanks, Pawan and Rasika. Let me go back to the question. So number one is, I will try to divide this question in a couple of parts. First is, PhDs need to feel confident that they have much more to give to industry than others. Mm-hmm. Why? Number one, we bring technical skills. Science is getting complex and complex. If you are dealing with the scientific community and you can't talk science, it is challenging. If someone is talking about artificial intelligence in drug discovery, if someone is talking about microbiome, I was talking to someone who is talking about how microbiome can help in creating therapeutics for COVID-19. These are the complex topics. Which I don't think if you don't have a strong technical knowledge, you can explain. So that is something which we have to understand, that there is a requirement of technical experts in the industry. Second, what skills or the soft skills we acquire as a PhD student? We understand complex scientific problems, which is one skill. Second, when it comes to solving problem, we don't go with a gut feeling based non-factual approach to solve problem. Everything need to be a scientific approach, logical experimental approach of problem solving. I was talking to someone, some people can call us nerds or whatsoever, but nerds are cool. They are gonna bring lot of things which others can't bring. And then if you are having better connection with the customer's problem, and scientific approach to solve the problem, that's what organizations need. But then second part is, Bhavan, what you mentioned, that what are the challenges with PhDs? Where are they stuck? Now, here we come on the second side, or the drawbacks. Like, we like to solve problems in silo. Rasika, if you will get a problem from your boss, I know what you are gonna do. You will come in the room, you will open your laptop, and you will start searching for all the publication and how to solve problems. You are not gonna go to call Pawan and say, hey, let's put a group of five and look into this problem and solve it. So we are not the team players. Sometimes we go too deep into the problem. We start from that how to solve this, but we keep going, and then we say, okay, yeah, my problem was finding which microbes in this water, but I am finding how to study the microbiome of entire ocean. So we go too deep into the problem. We don't know how to be brief in conversation. Even when we are talking, I can be brief, but being a PhD, I can keep going with a lot of analogies. And we can be quite emotional about our proposed solutions. If we do all these things, it's a problem. We don't know how to get detached from something. Detachment is another area. So whenever you look into the strength and the weaknesses, these are the strength and weaknesses, how you overcome these weaknesses, be self-aware that these are the problems you have. Find a mentor who can help you in addressing this problem, and learn to see the problems with the different lens, and it's the lens of people. How this problem will be seen by someone else who is not a PhD. So that these are the three things I will suggest. I can repeat it again because it's important for everyone to know. Understand your strength, understand your weaknesses by self-awareness, find a mentor to solve these problems, and start seeing problems from the lens of people, different people who are not PhDs.
This you are talking, like I completely agree with what you are talking. Like, I, coming from a PhD background, I know how elaborate we are talking about more of a scientific, like how to solve the scientific way. But I just wanted to know, like, so I'm sure like MBA or that kind of training has given you this perspective to look towards the problem, right? So can I just ask one thing, like, so MBA after PhD, or MBA after master's, like, you know, how do you look at it? Like, it doesn't matter that master's and then MBA, or bachelor's and MBA, or PhD and MBA. How do you look at the differences with this kind of thing to solve the problems?
Yeah, I agree, because most of time, even PhD struggle or postdoc think, oh, maybe I have to do MBA to get into a business job.
Yeah, and many times people might have that in mind that, oh, why I spend that, if I wanted to do anyways MBA, why I spend 5 years? Do you think that is that worth, or is like, oh, no, what is your perspective?
So, good question. If you look into MBA, now if someone is doing his master's or undergrad and after that they are taking management degree, that's a different career. They can also become marketing head like me, but they will come with a different skill sets. Master's doesn't teach us a lot of problem solving, or it doesn't help us in getting deeper into the scientific problems. So that's a different subset of people. Here, if I look into PhDs and MBA, that's a different subset of people. In my team, as well as in different teams, we are having a lot of people with PhDs and MBA. If you have done your PhD and then you are going for MBA degree, question is, when should I do it?
Yeah.
Number one, I did my MBA 10 years after my PhD. So I did my PhD in 2007, and then I did my MBA in 2017-18. So sometimes I feel I should have done it a little earlier, sometimes I feel I did it at the right time. So I feel once you spend few years of postdoc or post-postdoc experience like in industry, then you will appreciate learning of MBA more than if you will go directly after PhD. Why? Because after PhD, you are gonna look into it as a scientific subject. You are gonna look into how I can get maximum text out of it and get maximum high pass or grades. Like when you are in Vashu, then go to All In Business School sometime and talk to MBA students and talk to fresh MBAs and EMBAs, you will see the difference. So now if you're going after 5 years or 10 years, whatever period in industry, you will appreciate it more from a practical perspective. You will see what is there in it for me. Second, you will be able to implement those learnings immediately into your work. I remember when I was doing MBA, every time I will go to the class and come back, I will come up with some projects within my team. Hey guys, this is something I learned and I think it can be good for us. So you learn much more than just textbook stuff. So do after 5 years. If you want to grow in organization into general management,
I agree. Like
5 or 10.
I think we should only do it when we feel that we need it, rather than just for fancy stuff of doing it and then thinking, okay, where to apply? Now what to do with this? Got an MBA. So I certainly see your point that, you know, see the utility and then try to get it. Otherwise, just for fashion, it's not gonna help anyways. Okay. Yeah, so I have another question which is kind of connected to this, is about so I think we touched on a lot of things about your career journey, but viewer would be also interested about your current job. What kind of work, if you want to just give an idea, what kind of work you do as a Asia Pacific marketing head, and where you see that your skills are being utilized, which you built over so many, 12 years, right? So, yeah.
So, now as a head of commercial marketing for APAC, this is more of a leadership role where key job is how to empower people to take decisions, how to help team to find their right potential and appreciate the learning which we all had during last many years or during our career, to find how to transform the organization. We are going post-COVID, every organization is going through the changes. How the world will look like post-COVID, we don't know. So we spend a lot of time on future ways of working. We spend a lot of time on how to get people trained into new technologies, including database decision making, and how to empower teams. These are the areas where we spend time, where I use my PhD experience. I use it for show off though. Like when I'm talking to people, I say, okay, I'm gonna explain you how the drug discovery process look like and how the AI can play a role in it. How the synthetic biology is the next cool thing. I was reading yesterday, one of the trend in pharma will be printed pills. Can you imagine, like, instead of getting the pills from Pfizer and Johnson & Johnson,
wow,
you're having a machine which can print the pills for you in a personalized medicine world.
Right.
So now, a lot of people, these are not something they know. So I try to get what are the new trends in the market and then help my team of leaders, like our research leadership team in Asia Pacific, to understand these concepts, how the world is changing and how we need to be prepared for the challenges which we are going to face further.
So just a prelude to this question.
Everything is changing its face.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A small thing, like, so now you are at a higher position, so definitely you have to do many things or you know. So does your company have certain like training programs before, like this is gonna be like more of, I mean, I'm just interested to know, how do you, what are the resources you use to find out these things? Is it like a specific databases or training program, or just voluntary searches?
Okay, so learning is, now I am getting into how Merck or Millipore Sigma see learning. We spend a lot of time around curiosity. In one of the survey recently, people find that people in Merck are 9 or 10% higher point curious than other organization of similar size. So how we do it, like curiosity, we are the most curious mind in the world. That's the tagline we use. So we have innovation centers. We ask our teams to find new challenges. So anyone in my team or anyone in the organization, whether you are a sales rep, marketing person or whatsoever, you can come up with your own scientific or non-scientific innovation ideas. You can go to innovation center, pitch for that idea. If they like your idea, if there is a potential in that idea, they are going to fund you. You can go to Darmstadt, you can spend multiple years. I remember we had one guy who was data analyst. He did his master's in bioinformatics, as well as biotech, I believe. And he came up with a pretty cool idea around liquid biopsy. And then he got funded from Innovation Center. And now he's running his own project, his own kind of startup with help of Innovation Center in Darmstadt, Germany. That's what we do. So there is an intention to seed curiosity in people's mind. And every leader brings a lot of knowledge, experience. I spend a lot of time reading about this stuff. Merck give a lot of training around various development areas. People can select their own development plan from diversity and inclusion to curiosity. That help us to be, stay curious and learn more. So,
awesome. Good to know that that exists, because generally people think in from academic side is that in business you work for them, get money and that's it. So there is no career development or future development. But I see from your words that there is a lot of things to build on while you're into jobs. Okay, that's really good to know.
Right, that's so awesome to know that. Yeah, once you enter into a company, there are so many pathways which you can follow, and like you can follow your passion. So, but like this is what we have discussed when you are into like a business or when you get a job. But like I would like to know more of my perspective, or someone with right now what we are in the shoes, who are doing PhD or doing masters in maybe life sciences and who want to pursue career like you. So are there any pre-planned steps? Like, for example, if you would have been at this position right now, any pre-planned steps do you recommend? Any part, like, because people are in a very different part of India or world, right? And with the COVID, we have explored so many online resources, right? So are there anything which you suggest to our audience that we should really, like, you know, we can do some online courses or anything you would have done to take such career path?
Okay. Thanks, Rasika. So every time when I get a call from someone, people say, you know, I am done with my research work and now I want to come into industry. I ask, okay, what do you mean by coming to industry? What you want to do? I can do anything. Okay, but do you want to come into R&D or sales or marketing or regulatory? What you want to do? Sometimes people are very clear. Sometimes people say, sales and marketing is not something I appreciate. I want to still come into R&D. So number one, what's most important is you need to understand what are the career opportunities in the industry, and you need to define which one of these is best suited for your passion or your skills. Let's say if you feel you are someone who love to talk to people, who love traveling, who want to go and explore the interactions with the strangers or whatever you might say. And you also feel like you're a serious person from heart, in terms of you can sell anything. Say, okay, I want to make career in sales or in marketing. You feel you are someone who love exploring, reading, and getting into details of the subject. You might say, I want to make career in regulatory compliances. Or you can say, you might like solving problems. You say, I want to be field application scientist. I want to be research and development scientist. Prioritize those. This is most important. So that when someone is calling you and they are going to ask you this first question, why you want this job, then you have a clarity why you want this job. So that's the first preparation. Second is networking. Very, very important. And please, please, please don't go to people's LinkedIn and start writing, hey, I am looking for this job. Kindly look at my profile in LinkedIn and let me know if there is anything suitable available for us. Now, just imagine what you are doing. You are sending them an email or a message. First call to action you want from them is they open your email. Second, you want them to go and see your profile. Third, call to action you want from them is to email you. And they don't know you. They don't know anything about you. And you want them to do three steps. Everyone is busy in their things. Please don't do it. Better is, this is a tip for everyone. The mostly people who are into leadership role are in Generation X. Generation X, if you will search in Google, they still like to do a lot of calls and talk to people face to face. So find a time to contact them on phone or ask them for meeting. Say just you want to meet, learn about them. They're gonna probably meet you and then discuss with them that this is my career aspiration. How do you want me to proceed with this? So people remember who they meet or who they talk. People don't remember who send them the messages on LinkedIn. Okay, so don't over-engineer yourself on LinkedIn. That's the second thing around networking. Third is be visible. What does it mean? Start writing things like blogs or any voluntary activity for organization like iStemCare, you guys are doing. Be visible, participate in conferences. Now, post-COVID, again, the conferences will start. Be active in those interactions. Mostly, if I am looking from an Indian's perspective, depending upon from where you are, you can be too shy also, and you can be too over-speaking also. So, overspoke. So, the last thing is, which is specifically for PhDs, and please, 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 I apologize if I am saying this, be well dressed when you go anywhere. I seen a lot of time people come in sports shoes and not shaved or not properly dressed, especially for guys. Girls are still like usually don't do that, but be properly dressed when you are going for any interaction. I say whether you are on a call or you are on meeting people, people are gonna judge you. I've been judged multiple times in my life on how I am dressed or how I behave. So be well dressed when you are going for interacting with people. Just remember these few things. It's not gonna be easy, but most of you experience it's gonna be easier than getting a postdoc, because for postdoc you apply to 1,000 places and then you get it. It's not gonna be super easy, but it's easy to get into
industry. I agree.
Thanks. That and
if somebody wants to get something, be intentional. Don't take it casual, otherwise things will never come in line. It's not gonna be happening automatically or like it's like keep on doing research and some paper will come out of it. That approach may not work in career crafting or career planning, because till the time we are not intentional, nothing going to come out of it. I think I agree with your like really, really important suggestion.
Right, and being visible and networking is very important tip. I feel you have given that. Yes, that's
yeah.
And
I mean,
where generally most of us we lack, right?
Yeah. Last thing I have from you to know about. So you worked around 10 years in Indian like field work in working across the institute and looking and drafting with all the PhDs and early career researchers, and you have seen the transition. So what the change you see as compared to in 2009 to 2000 now to 2021, right, in terms of attitude of academic kind of I'd say ecosystem towards interfacing with the industry, and how can the early career researcher can leverage that change in attitude to transition easily in such non-academic jobs?
Yeah, so changes, of course, about awareness. I remember in 2007, how I came to know about job for Merck Millipore was not like someone putting it on LinkedIn, or there was no LinkedIn probably at that time. There was nothing in social media. People were not going a lot to those Naukri.com or Monster.com. So someone called me from the same institute. So Vandana Gambhir, who was my PhD senior, someone approached her that way, you will be interested in this job. And then Vandana was like, okay, I am not interested, but I know someone who might be interested. And then she told me, okay, are you interested in this job? That's how we used to get the information. Now, social has helped us in reaching out to people much easier. I remember I wanted to interact with someone in industry, so I went to my PhD boss Samurai Chaudhary and I asked Professor Chaudhary that, can you connect me with someone you know in industry? And he said, yeah, I know this person and I know this person, you can talk to them. And that also played a role, because my first boss in Merck Millipore, he was a batchmate of my PhD boss. So of course, like some recognition might have worked at that time. It doesn't mean like I'm not qualified to I was not qualified for that job, but yes, those were the approaches where things were more physically connected. Folks that they did PhD together and then he was my boss, so I got the job. Now it's more networking on LinkedIn and all different Instagram, Twitter, etc. You find who is working in this company, who is probably connected or she's probably connected to, how I can reach out to that person. So networking is in a different dimension. Second is how people appreciate these jobs is also better. I remember, I will not tell the name of the institute, I remember after PhD, I went for installation of some product to one institute, and PhD student treated me so badly, I can't explain. Like, I was standing there for a couple of hours and I asked like where I can go for lunch, and he was like, why you guys don't get salary to have your own lunch, you want subsidized lunch in the institute. I was feeling so bad that after PhD, he's a second year PhD student, how can he speak to me like this? But then company trained you to be polite, to say, okay, thank you, sir. I will wait here. Now the world is changed. People are appreciating this non-conventional job. Scientists, students, they treat everyone respectfully. This might be generation gap also, I am not sure, but that's a big, big change which I see. Third is connection globally. Like during old days, people were not that connected across the globe. They were like they might write to some professors for postdocs or to get some strains or clones. They will write to certain people, but they were not connecting with each other and appreciating, hey, I like your paper and this and that. So now the world is more connected. And all these things make PhDs much more cool. And I'm using this word cool in a very cautious way. We are cool people now. People like to interact with us. People like to date with PhDs. So this is a change which I can see happening here.
Yeah, I agree.
Just to keep it a little light.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, I have seen like the receptivity because of integration between industry, and in almost every successful project definitely have industry collaboration or integration. So the new generation PIs, even the guides and that had changed, and which is reflecting back into the trainees or the PhDs or postdocs mindset. And I think that's really a good step, because if there is attitude and there is an interest, and that's where the mindset changes start. Otherwise, we just become ignorant of the other world. Just don't want to see and look at it. Yeah, so I think with that, we would want to hear your final advice to our viewers, to listeners, which could be early career researchers, like masters, PhDs and postdoc. Who would want to get into marketing or industry related, these non-bench related jobs. So what would be your final advice if you want to just summarize your whole discussion?
Yeah, so I believe I was giving a lot of advice to people. So I will just summarize it in three steps. Define what you want to do. You might go in that direction 100%, or you might be having some success, but define where you want to go. Second, acquire right skills. People are gonna remember you for two things: how knowledgeable you are and how good and nice you are in communicating that knowledge to others. So you need to acquire skills not just of technical, but how you are kind to people, how you are good to people. So he's being PhD, learn those social skills also, which can make you closer to the community, and that's very, very important. Third is networking. Ensure you are networking well, so you can get good job. Fourth is lifelong learning. If just to share this week, I shared with you, Pawan, I was going through a general leadership program or a global leadership program. We have to continuously keep learning. So that lifelong learning is very critical. So these are the four things. Remember that, and trust yourself, have confidence in yourself. Be a good communicator. It helps a lot if possible. You will have great success. That's how I see it. And reach out to people, even to me, anyone, anytime you guys need any help. I am based out of Seoul, South Korea. So if you are in US, your evening is great to connect with me in my morning. If you are in India, anytime in your day is probably I am awake, unless you are a night person. Your night will be midnight for me. But reach out to us. We will we'll have chit chat. We will try to find how we can help each other.
Right, right. And like before we wrap up, like what is the best way to connect? Like on which platforms you are generally available for any of our listeners?
Oh, how did we connect?
LinkedIn, I think LinkedIn is the best. That's what I think he's been talking, networking. So that's what I think. It's not Facebook networking for sure. What he talks about is LinkedIn, I believe. You can clarify.
I have my Clubhouse, which is a cool new platform. I created a club called Life Science and Biotech. I know it is only for iPhone users, But as soon as Android comes, please join the Clubhouse. We are going to have fun there. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. Send me whatever your questions are. I will try to respond or can share my number if you want to chat. I'm not using Facebook a lot, but on social, WhatsApp, Telegram, whatever, Kakao, Baidu, Line, WeChat, I have my social things on each of these platforms, because Pawan, I am not sure it is just for Indian community, but if there are Chinese people, they can reach out to me on WeChat. If there are Koreans, they can reach out to me on Kakao.
Awesome.
I am on these platforms. And that's another message is, don't select the platform which you like, select the platform where you can interact with more people. So, of different cultures. So,
yeah.
That's another thing.
I mean, that's really nice that you are available despite your busy life over many platforms. That itself speaks your helping and, you know, helping attitude to the new people or people want to learn. So I think certainly people are going to benefit, and you'll get definitely, once we publish this podcast, a lot of requests for helping, mentoring. So
remember, it is reverse mentoring. I am going to learn from people. That's the reason I asking
you. Yeah, that's your humbleness. But I think it's the flow of the water will be more from your side to the other people. So with that, I think we'll wrap our discussion today. And I really kind of enjoyed talking to you on different aspects we covered. And I would sincerely would like to thank for giving the time with us to share your career journey with the community at large. So this podcast will go across the globe. It's not just limited to any particular country. So with that, I think we will wrap here.
Thank you, Pawan.
All right. Okay. So
thanks, Pawan and Rasika. This is second time I'm interacting with you guys, and you guys are awesome. I love talking to you guys. Thanks for giving me this opportunity. I wish you best for this great initiative. I thank all the audience who joined us today, and I'm looking forward to listen to other speakers who you guys will bring. So best of luck.